Homomorphic encryption, or HE, is one of the technologies that we at OpenMind use to help answer questions from data you cannot see. In this video, we will explore what HE is, what are its pros and cons, and we will introduce the theory behind why it works. So, let's begin. Homomorphic encryption is a form of encryption that allows computation on encrypted data. In short, HE ensures that performing operations on encrypted data and decrypting the results is equivalent to performing analogous operations without any encryption. This technology has numerous applications that range from healthcare to smart electric grids, from education to machine learning as a service. All sectors where privacy is crucial and making use of the data is usually very complex due to regulations or just the significance of the data. So clearly, the main advantage of HE is that it enables model owners to perform inference and analysis on encrypted data, keeping the results encrypted as well. So that, for example, in a machine learning as a service scenario, the owner of the data doesn't need to fully trust the service that he uses. Then, differently from other related technologies like secure multi-party computation, HE does not require interactivity. So again, in a machine learning as a service scenario, data owners can send their encrypted data to model owners and simply wait to receive the results. Meanwhile, the disadvantages of homomorphic encryption regard primarily efficiency concerns and the overhead that using this technique requires over performing the same operations on non-encrypted data. Alright, so now that we have a clearer idea of what HE is, we might want to apply it to our own data. And that's where PySift, one of OpenMind's libraries, comes in handy, providing implementations of the Parallel scheme, which is limited to addition, and soon of the CKKS encryption scheme, which supports more complex operations. Using these schemes is relatively straightforward. For Parallel, we start by importing just Sift and Torch. Then we hook Torch to add to the object of this library, like tensors, the functionalities that we need from Sift. After these steps, we generate the public key that we will use for encryption and the private key that we will use for decryption. At this point, we can initialize and encrypt two tensors, X and Y, and sum them together. This scheme doesn't enable other homomorphic operation, but it is much faster than more complex schemes and has a small overhead. The sum tensor decrypts, of course, to the correct result. Using CKKS will be only slightly more complex. Besides Sift and Torch, we will have to import a Python wrapper of the CL library from Microsoft that implements the scheme in fast C++ code. Then we will proceed by hooking Torch, generating the keys and initializing the encrypted tensors. Sift, at first, will support efficient addition, subtraction and multiplication on CKKS tensors, although the scheme is not limited in the operation it enables. Understanding the difference between partially homomorphic encryption schemes, those limited to certain specific operations, and fully homomorphic encryption schemes, those that support arbitrary functions, is crucial. So let's focus more specifically on fully homomorphic encryption and explain what it means to compute arbitrary functions. Well, if we want to compute a function on a computer, we will have to find a way to express it as a sequence of combinations of logic gates. Writing out the 16 possible functions that take two binary inputs, you can see that the AND and XOR gates are enough to express all of them, and thus they form a complete set of gates. More interestingly, AND and XOR are operations respectively of binary multiplication and addition. From this, we can infer that if an homomorphic encryption scheme supports sequences of additions and multiplications, then it should be able to compute arbitrary functions. The operations of addition and multiplication suggest the use of a ring as the underlying algebraic structure. An example of a ring is the set of integers modulo n, let's say 5. We can imagine this set projected on a circle split into 5 sectors. This set is a ring because it has both the neutral elements, 0 and 1, and both the usual addition and multiplication operations. Besides homomorphic addition and multiplication, what are the other characteristics common to most FHE schemes? Well, they tend to be based on schemes that are capable of somewhat homomorphic encryption. These schemes can only perform a limited number of successive multiplication and addition operations on ciphertext before the results become unreliable and impossible to decrypt. This limitation arises directly from the way these systems guarantee security by relying on random noise, to make relatively simple problems computationally intractable. From here, we will build our own scheme, to see more practically just how hard it is to support long sequences of additions and multiplications on secure ciphertext. A very interesting talk from Craig Gentry one of the most prominent researchers in the field, will be our guide. In it, among other things, he introduces an interesting framework to approach this form of encryption. The Polycracker framework aims to use encryptions of zero to disguise any message. In practice, we can use this idea to build a simple scheme that encrypts a 1-bit message, so it can either be 0 or 1, and that operates in the ring of integers modulo a large prime p that should always remain hidden. It is, in fact, the secret key. Let's start with the encryption procedure. If we want to encrypt a generic message m, we first choose randomly both a small noise term r and also a large q. The encryption of m, cpm, will simply be m plus 2r plus qp. So essentially, we are circling the p size wheel q times and then adding an even value to r. In the end, the parity of the point on the wheel on which we end up represents the message. So decryption is as easy as taking the mod p of the ciphertext and then the mod 2 of the result. The mod p operation removes the qp factor, and then we are left with m plus 2r, which is even if m is equal to 0, and odd if it is equal to 1. As simple as that. Addition works intuitively. Let's say that we have cpm1 and cpm2, the encryptions of two messages, but we don't know the secret key p. We can still compute a valid encryption of M1 plus M2, albeit with more noise, by adding together the encryptions of the two messages that we have available. We can verify it by retracing the encryption as if it was applied to M1 plus M2 directly. Of course, multiplication works in a similar way, but we can see that in that case, the noise term grows much faster. Before talking about why a growing noise term is such a crucial issue, let's focus on why we need it in the first place. If we were to remove the noise from our scheme, it would still be capable of performing homomorphic addition and multiplication. However, to break the noiseless scheme, an attacker would just need to get a hold of two messages and proceed by simply calculating the greatest common factor. If we add noise, the problem becomes much more difficult, and in the literature it is known as the approximate GCD or approximate common divisor problem, and with reasonable parameters, it is considered to be hard to solve. Approximate GCD is not the only problem used to secure fully homomorphic encryption. In fact, numerous recent schemes employ the learning with errors or LWE problem, which is also conjectured to be hard to solve. Even schemes that rely on LWE, however, see the noise rise as successive additions are performed, and even more so with multiplications. To understand why that is a problem, we'll go back to our scheme with an example. Let's say, to keep things simple, that we would like to add to itself a message m equals 0 three times. 1982 is a valid encryption of 0, using secret key p equals 29. 3 times 1982 is 5946, and as always, 5946 doesn't tell us much about the result of our calculation. But with p, we can decrypt it, as we detailed above. We start with 5946 mod 29, which is equal to 1, and then we check whether the result is even or odd. 1 is odd, so we conclude that 3 times m is equal to 1. But of course, we know that that is not the case, since m is equal to 0. So, what went wrong? The error term has gotten too big, and instead of being even, it's now odd. Since 30 is bigger than 29, the modulo p operation that usually doesn't affect the error because it's too small, now has changed it, corrupting the decryption. So, is there a way to decrease the error? Yes, bootstrapping, a technique that involves running the decryption procedure homomorphically without revealing the message and using an encrypted version of the secret key. To give a sense of how this is possible, we should keep in mind that we can produce a series of additions and multiplications that perform the decryption operation, in our scheme, modulo p followed by modulo 2. Furthermore, the scheme we presented here encrypts binary messages, so to get an encryption of the secret key, we simply need to have an ordered set of the encryptions of its bits. With these two ingredients, we can perform homomorphic decryption and eliminate the noise produced by previous operations. Homomorphic decryption, however, introduces some noise of its own, like any other function. But as long as we can still perform reliably one operation of addition or of multiplication before needing bootstrapping again, we have reached fully homomorphic encryption. And so this is the recipe for most proposed FHE schemes, an underlying somewhat homomorphic encryption scheme that supports addition and multiplication, usually secured by adding noise, and a way to reduce the noise when it grows too large, usually bootstrapping. So hopefully now you know a little bit more about this great technology, and if you want to dive deeper, in the article accompanying this video on the OpenMind blog, we have gathered useful links to other learning resources that focus on specific protocols and expand on the topics we mentioned today. For bootstrapping in particular, we are working on a dedicated post to elaborate on the high-level introduction of this video. This post will be published as part of the Privacy Preserving Data Science Explained series, along with articles on privacy by shuffling, secure multiparty computation, and federated learning, which are already online, and a comprehensive mini-series on differential privacy, which is in the works. Our blog is also a great place to learn more about other privacy-preserving technologies and to find practical tutorials on all of our libraries. So check it out and share your favorite article, tutorial, or video to let other people know about OpenMind. Lastly, a big thank you to all the people from our community that made this video possible, and thank you for watching.